Good morning. So glad you all could be here with us. And good morning to everybody watching live on Zoom or who will watch this later. As you've heard, these sessions really do get a lot of subsequent viewership, which makes us all very happy because there's a lot new to say every year. Even if you've watched the previous videos, you know, this is a field that is constantly changing. And you know, with that in mind, I'm sure everyone in the room is familiar with what prostate cancer is, where the prostate is, hopefully at this point. The key thing though is really understanding which of the prostate cancers can spread, can metastasize to other parts of the body. And I find it always helpful to think about the epidemiology, the broad level view of what this cancer is doing in America and worldwide, because it really changes year to year with changes in federal policy, with how we screen and how we think about the disease. So in 2025, prostate cancer remains by far the most common cancer diagnosed among men in the US and the second leading cause of cancer death among men in the US. This number, the mortality figure in particular, has changed year over year with screening practices. And when we talk about overtreatment and overdiagnosis, and yes, there is overdiagnosis, the reason it's so important to have that conversation is because if we want to fix the mortality problem, we need to screen for the disease very aggressively. And to do that, we have to convince our colleagues in primary care that we are not going to overtreat when we find low-grade disease. So over time, the numbers have really changed. Incidence, this is the number of cancers we find every year, really reflects what primary care doctors do. Are they offering PSA testing or not, right? So when PSA started in the 1990s, we saw a huge spike in incidence. We found all these men who had been living with the disease. Things sort of stabilized in the 2000s. Then in 2012, we got this D recommendation, don't screen anybody ever, which is what the US Preventive Services Task Force said with a D recommendation. Incidence crashed to the lowest levels we've seen since the 1980s, not because cancer went away, but because we just stopped looking for it. Now the pendulum is kind of swinging back, hopefully somewhere toward the middle. We got this C recommendation in 18, which is, well, we don't really think this is a good idea, but you should have a conversation with your primary care doctor about it, okay, is what the C means. In the meantime, mortality figures, now these data go back to the 30s, so it's a longer X-axis here. Since the 1990s, in the screening era, mortality has fallen for prostate cancer faster than any cancer except lung cancer, which we know we can explain because of screening practices. Because of smoking cessation, this is flattened, and we've really sort of lost this momentum. And in the meantime, we know that this is the cancer with the greatest racial disparity of any major cancer, and we've made very little progress here. We've seen comparable declines for white and black men, but really no narrowing of the gap. And if anything, rates of mortality are rising faster for black men than for anybody else. So, you know, 2012 was exactly the wrong time to stop screening for this disease. But the reason we got this recommendation was because of the variability of the cancer. And we know this is any screening for any cancer, colonoscopy, mammography, what have you. Now, the idea is you screen at intervals. If you get to the far right, you've died of the cancer. You've died of something else. If you get to the top, you've died of the cancer. And we know there are tons that we don't find the snails, even with screening. There's a lot that we can find. We can cure it, right? We can treat it. But if we never found it, it would not have caused any symptoms with respect to life. Then there's the rabbits, the ones that we can, in fact, cure with surgery, radiation therapy, other treatments before they would cause lethal disease. And then birds, you know, the ones that we cannot find because they happen so quickly, that's fortunately very uncommon in prostate cancer. And the snails are a big deal. If we look at autopsy studies, men who make it to their 70s and 80s, 50% of all men have some funny looking cells in their prostate that a pathologist would call cancer. This is not cancer the way we think about it. And this gets to this overdiagnosis issue. And the fact is we're trying really hard in 2025 not to find grade group one or Gleason 3+3. You're gonna hear a lot more about grading in a minute from Dr. Ding. But you know, grade group one prostate cancer is not cancer the way we think about it. It never ever spreads. And we're trying hard not to find it. So if you have an elevated PSA today, you should be offered an MRI or one of now seven different urine and blood tests, all of which are intended to find grade group two or higher. If the test is negative, the implication is, well, either you've got nothing or you've got grade group one. And in either of those scenarios, we don't do the biopsy. So as a urology community doing diagnosis for prostate cancer, we are explicitly or maybe implicitly trying not to find the grade group ones. So grade group one is not, like I said, it's not cancer the way we're all here to talk about cancer. And the reality is this is working. So in the days of the capture registry, which Carol started back in 1995, 50% of all the cancers we found were low risk, grade group one, small early PSA. This has really changed over time. The right graph here is the AQUA registry, which the American Urological Association started and captures 25% of all the urologists in the country now. So in the more contemporary era, this is the 2010s and early 20s, fewer than 20% of men have low-risk prostate cancer. This is a sea change. In the UK, where you basically cannot get a biopsy without having a spot visible on your MRI, this rate is about 6%. Okay, so you know, it's not to say the low-risk prostate cancer is going away, but we're trying not to find it because the focus is on the high-grade disease. Finding grade group one is not the point of screening. And we finally have implemented this at UCSF. So as of 2019, after a two-year conversation with our leadership in primary care, who initially were very much kind of in lockstep with the task force, you know, the medical students are all taught that PSA is a terrible test. Now, PSA is the best screening test in the history of oncology if you use it well. So we finally have baked into our primary care electronic health record system a, you know, what we consider a smarter screening initiative. So the idea is between 45 and 75, you should get a PSA test. If it's low, and for 75% of the population, it's under one, you're done. You could be done for life. We say don't check again for 5 years. But the reality is that test, if you have a PSA under one in midlife, you can pretty much write off prostate cancer for the next 25 years. There's incredibly good data to support this. If it's higher, you notice 4.0 is nowhere on this slide. So, you know, up to over two for younger men, 45 to 60, over three for older men, we think about referral, secondary testing, not biopsy, but those tests that I just mentioned, blood and urine tests and MRI. If it's intermediate, then it's certainly customized. Again, race, family history, anxiety. Some people would prefer to have a biopsy, some would not. And this is actually working. We are slowly seeing rates of screening rising at UCSF, particularly for Black men at UCSF. And we've seen this despite the COVID pandemic, which tended to, you know, really drop screening rates across the country and around the world. But the tenet here is we're recommending the screening paradigm with the assumption that basically 100% of the low-risk disease goes to active surveillance. We are not over-treating anything grade group one with surgery or radiation or focal therapy or anything else. So which ones do need treatment? We've talked a lot about over-treatment. So, you know, again, the ones that are grade group one, they're low risk. These are the turtles on that screen. These would never cause any symptoms, never threaten life, if we had not found them. And it is, you know, you all know the cliche that most men die with prostate cancer, not other. The problem again, though, is that subset are the ones that are the rabbits do still kill more men than any other cancer. Those are the ones that we need to find, the aggressive prostate cancers. This is the ones, you know, grade group three and higher. Some of the grade group twos, you're gonna hear about unfavorable histology, the ones that actually we can tell based on how they look and based on their molecular profile, which ones really need attention. And every single prostate cancer needs to be risk stratified at diagnosis. Low risk disease, like I said, we follow with active surveillance. And one of our goals here these days is to really even tone down the intensity of active surveillance for men at the lowest risk. We are doing more and more focal therapy, which we'll hear about a little bit later from Wen, for tumors that are sort of group two, visible, but pretty small and early. More aggressive cancers need local therapy with surgery and radiation therapy, often with a combination of this multimodal therapy, combining treatments, maybe combining with systemic treatment as well, with hormonal therapy and other medications. And only the highest risk ones these days, only the ones that are actually, you know, significantly metastatic at diagnosis, receive systemic treatment alone. And we're making progress. This is national data, again, from the American Urological Association registry. The use of active surveillance across the country has gone up from barely a quarter to nearly 60%. Over the prior decade. This is pretty rapid progress in the right direction, but it's also not nearly enough. That means we're still over-treating 40% of the low-risk disease at the time of diagnosis without even a test period of surveillance. And there's an incredible amount of variation. This is this plot is basically showing individual urologists around the country. This is the individual urology practices along the X. Individual urologists along the Y, is the likelihood of getting active surveillance if you show up at this practice to this urologist's door with low-risk disease. So depending on which urology practice in the US you go to, 250 practices around the country, likelihood of surveillance ranges from 0 to 80%. Depending on which urologist you happen to knock on the door, 0 to 100%. Okay. Now, this is not unique to urologists or active surveillance. This is the small area variations problem we see everywhere in healthcare, but it's a huge problem. Literally on Wednesday, I saw a patient who was told by his local urologist for his two cores of 3+3, he should go straight to surgery because he was 59 years old. outrageous. And this is in the Bay Area, right? It's worse in smaller parts of the country. So we need to risk stratify. You're going to hear a lot about these parameters as the morning goes on. Grade in particular, and the way we're thinking about pathology these days, in some cases, we will augment this with genomic tests and with pathology AI. And ultimately, you're going to hear about risk groups. This is the NCCN risk classification. There's one from the AUA. It's gotten a little bit complex and a little bit cumbersome. The very low risk group has really gone away from the AUA, and hopefully it'll go away from the NCCN soon. We shouldn't even find these. This is honestly not a great way of doing it, but it's still the most common. The reason this risk stratification is not terrific is there's a lot of heterogeneity within those boxes. We have the CAPRA score here, which is now 20 years old, which uses the same variables, but it's a lot more accurate and precise in terms of stratifying them in terms of likelihood of the cancer actually causing the problem. And just to emphasize the point about, you know, variability within these boxes, now, these are two men you can look at at a glance. They have very different tumors. The one on the left with a low PSA density, that's the PSA related to the size of the prostate, low stage. There's a little bit of 3+4, but it's only a fused gland subtype. You'll hear about that more in a minute. Unfavorable intermediate because there's a lot of Gleason 3-3 here, 7 out of 12 cores. It's called unfavorable in a lot of radiation oncology hands. That means, you know, extended hormonal therapy if you're going down the radiation path. The guy on the right, you know, much more aggressive cancer, intraductal, higher grade, also unfavorable intermediate. They're in the same bucket. The CAPRA score will clearly separate them in terms of risk. And this is just what it looks like by CAPRA here. As you go to the right here, you want to stay at the top of the screen. This is the percentage of the men that are still alive and have not died of prostate cancer. Low risk disease, almost nobody dies. This is up to 16 years now. In the capture registry, higher risk disease, almost half of all men are, you know, can die of the disease within 10 years. So, but that's the uncommon situation. Most of the cancers are in the low and intermediate range of things. And it's important to remember that even high risk prostate cancer survival at 5 years is basically 100% when the disease is localized. And we have more medications for advanced disease than we know what to do with today. You're gonna hear about that a lot as well in the afternoon. Treatments both for localized and advanced disease are improving every year. And many of the side effects can be managed. And these are all themes we're going to touch on throughout the rest of the day. You always have time to make a decision. This is a disease that moves typically over years and over decades. Don't rush into things and make treatment decisions that resonate with you, your family, and your priorities. So with that, we'll pass it on.